between the left or in a top two primary, where you have to look at like who's gonna advance and can I really vote for that person? But if they're not, you know, you don't know if you're gonna waste your vote. And so it looks like that is why that turnout here in Colorado Springs increases in the second round, in the runoff, because you know you're not wasting your vote. There's only two choices. So we think that's why the participation goes up in here in the Springs and also in Denver. But you know, we want to make sure that people are honestly voting on their ballots and they're saying what it is they really, really want. Because you know, candidates get into office and they don't know if people were sincerely voting for them or holding their nose. So when a candidate gets into office in the first round, they know they've got a strong platform. If they need to go through a couple runoff rounds, they know they need to listen up to what those voters wanted first, right? To see there's other issues this community is concerned about. And that's why candidates are saying, one of the reasons they're saying they prefer it. So the voters get more voice. You're heard clearly for what it is you really mean. You get more choice because more candidates can safely get in the race. And they have a chance of winning, so they can actually raise some money. If they have good ideas, you know, they might win. So we see more women, more people of color, more working class people getting into the race if they have something to say about how the city should be run. So you get more choices on the ballot, and it's more fair in the long run because you know the winner earned the win.
So if you wanted to really weight your vote and just vote for one person in all your categories, can you do that?
Oh, good question. No. I mean, you can do that. You can do whatever you want on a ballot. But if your candidate is eliminated, there's no place for your ballot to go.
You lose it. But
that's right.
You could continue, you could still do it, and your other candidate might, or they could still, if there's a second choice, they could get it.
Your ballot
possibility.
No,
on
so
the second or third round, they might get them.
There's no place for it to go. So think of it as like buckets. So your candidate's bucket goes away. So your ballot has no place to go. So it becomes inactive.
If you're the lowest person on the.
That's right. So it's like if you vote, you know, pick a name. Mike. You know, if Mike's eliminated, your ballot's, you know, not heard anymore because you don't have your backup plan on there. So, and there was a candidate in Oregon that told their voters to do that. And when he was eliminated, all his voters' ballots became inactive. So we make sure that candidates understand to not do that. Ma'am.
How do you eliminate the number of candidates? We already have almost a dozen running for mayor, for example.
Yeah. So, yeah, you get, you know, a variety of people in the race.
And would that be reasonable that you could possibly have 12 candidates for one office? Or is that limited at the local level?
Oh, I see your point. Yeah, it's a local decision how many, you know, like what are the standards for getting on back on the ballot? Like how many signatures do you need, you know? So, and you want to make sure that the standards aren't too low.
Yeah,
right.
Because you might have them.
Because, right, like you have to stand in front of Walmart for at least 2 days getting those signatures. You know, we need you to be like serious about your campaign. And so the way it works at the debates is that I'd say, hey, Dutch, who are your top three favorite mayoral candidates? And then I'd say, well, here are my top three. And we've got overlap on this one point. Or we'd start talking about it that way. So it's a different conversation, even when you have as many as a dozen.
Okay, I have a couple of questions you might be getting into. One of which I thought was kind of interesting. So let's say, you know, with that example you had, and then of course chocolate chip won. But would chocolate chip realize, oh gee, all the chocolate people, I was their second choice, so I better keep their issues in mind when I mean, is that known to the candidates? You know what I'm saying? The chocolate is the people for the chocolate cookie issues, since they were all their second choices helped chocolate chip win. Right. Does that mean the candidate is going to say it wasn't just my chocolate chip issues that everybody was voting for, but they also like the chocolate candidates?
Right. They should know that.
I was going to say the good candidates do. The good ones.
We can't guarantee that they're going to be smart.
Okay, but they can know it. I mean, it's not like a secret, right?
That's right. It is clear and open to everybody how it is they built their coalition with.
So it would be to their own advantage to know, gee, absolutely, if I want to pull in more, okay, I should do that. Then my second question is, and maybe you're going to get to this, you mentioned about, I don't live in the city, so I didn't know the control mayor candidates, I live in the county. But if you're doing ranked choice voting, do they have to say, well, there's 12, so we need to have 12 choices, really? Can they say, you're only having 5, you have to pick your top 5, and then
back up to it.
Oh, back up, yes, ma'am, back up to the ballot.
So the way that works is the list can go down as far, I mean, like the, what the software and the printing can handle is 100 candidates.
Wow.
Not happening. So it can handle more than what would happen, but you are going to be limited to 6 choices.
Okay.
So we're not going to have a ballot that goes on, you know, folding out pages. No, it maxes out at 6.
Okay. So even though there's 12 candidates, you'd have to pick your top 6.
That's right.
Okay. Which is probably good. So I'll know my top 12 anyway.
Top 3 is plenty.
Top 3, I know.
So all 12 candidates are listed, but you only get the option to pick 6.
You rank your favorite 6.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah, absolutely.
Do those have more runoffs when you have more candidates like that?
Well, you know, half the time somebody runs or wins in the first round. And so when you have, and it's usually the front runner that ends up winning in the final round. So, but they're not limping into office in a weak political position. You can see who actually earned that win. And I will belabor 1992. It would have been good to have that cleared up because that was ugly. That was 8 years of impeachment and ridiculous stories that nobody needed to hear about. You know, it was unnecessary and we needed to get it cleared up one way or the other in the election. So anyway, editorial, yes. Mm-hmm.
No, I'm sorry, 1992. I'm not sure what, what you're referencing.
You.
I apologize.
Okay.
Sorry.
Thank you. 1992 was Ross Perot ran for president.
Oh, okay.
Ross the boss.
Yes.
And there was George Bush Sr. and then Bill Clinton. And so we had 3 presidential candidates and the votes, you know, got split. So in Colorado, a lot of those Perot voters would have preferred George Bush Sr. It's just, you know, he wasn't the most, he kind of lacked that warm, fuzzy feeling that people like. I mean, he did work for the CIA. So, I mean, he does not have that, hey, let's go get a beer kind of thing that people like. So anyway, so it's, it just wasn't cleared up in that election. So
what was not cleared up?
Well, who really deserved that win? Because there were people saying that Clinton didn't deserve the win. And it would have been good to have it one way or the other cleared up.
And Rick was it half? Did he get half the vote?
He did not.
But he got a plurality.
He got a plurality.
And so that he got the most votes in Colorado.
And he may well have won had it been ranked choice, but it would have been good to get it like settled. So people aren't walking around with that stone in their shoe feeling like this isn't right. And we didn't have to hear about it.
Yeah, because a lot of the Ross Perot voters might have picked Bush as second choice.
Right, and some of them would
have probably Bush, most of them would have.
Because they were, we will never know.
Well, and that's why they say, too, when you get a third party candidate in the elections right now, it usually just takes away from one of the Republicans or Democrats. That's all it's doing right now.
Right. And that limits the conversation because the minor parties have some very good points to make. You know, the libertarians bring up some excellent points about individual freedoms. And the Greens bring up some useful points about, didn't we used to have snow on those mountains? You know, I mean, they're during the summer. So they both bring up great points that we can look at. So pop back to presentation world, we have so ranked choice, it's been used for over 100 years, and it's being used around the country. So in Maine and Alaska, they use it in statewide races. Alaska, they didn't do a great job on their rollout. I asked them about their voter their candidate education, and they didn't really do it, which was like, they're getting up to speed. I'm like, thank you. So they're reaching out to Nick Begich and making sure that he's not running a negative campaign. So that campaign in Alaska was a Democrat and two Republicans. And kind of the politically middle candidate was eliminated, most of his votes went to the Democrat or to the inactive pile. And he didn't pick up enough votes in the first round because he didn't tell people what he planned to do in office. And you can't win just saying, vote for me, I'm conservative and I'm smarter than Sarah Palin. That doesn't tell me what you plan to do. So I hope he runs a better campaign next time. But I think we as voters deserve better information than what we've been getting. So now the places that use this, and Maine did very, very good. Utah has been using it. Our neighbors in New Mexico have been using it. And their candidates have been getting smart and running better campaigns focused on talking to the voters about what they plan to do in office. So now we've been using it in some of our mountain towns for over a decade and using it successfully. So we know how to use it with Colorado's elections laws. And our organization worked with the County Clerks Association to find out exactly what they need to have a successful rollout. You know, like, here's the video you need to put up on your website. Here's the, the study on the ballot instructions. You know, the study's already been run. So we know what things are going to look like. So, and it will be rolled out in a county coordinated race in Broomfield next year. So in 2023, they'll be using ranked choice for their mayor and city council. And that's, there are many other cities watching carefully to see how it goes and what the learning curve is. And, you know, if all goes well, expanding to more cities. So that's what we have going on here. It's been used in presidential primaries, and it also gets used for military and overseas voters in some of our southern states because they have majority runoff or, majority requirements for many of their seats. And if you're overseas, you're not 100% sure that you're going to get your ballot back in time. So that's why many of the of these states in here are using it. And actually, I need to update my slide. Georgia started in June. So
what does that mean, majority?
Okay, remember the 50% line?
Yeah.
Yep, so that's our majority threshold. So, and I'll give a Colorado
total population of voter registered.
Oh, okay, of the votes.
Votes cast,
but if the military hasn't come in yet,
yeah. And so if your ballot comes in late, it's not counted
because somebody got 50%.
Because your ballot wasn't even counted towards the universe that makes up that 50%. It's just your ballot showed up late, so we just stick it in a box and put it in the storage. But it doesn't get counted if your ballot shows up a month late. You know, just the same as being a regular voter here in the States, if you drop up a thing with the elections division a month late, they're like, we finished, we can't take this late ballot. So there are military voters' ballots in other states aren't getting counted.
So how does ranked choice help those groups?
Right, so in places that have a majority requirement, like Colorado Springs, we know their ballots are gonna get back in time because there isn't a separate runoff. It's the runoff ballots that don't get back in time. We have 3 months for them to get their ballots back for the first round. For the second round, it's 2 months. They don't always make it because it takes a lot of time to get ballots to and from, you know, some of the far-flung places where we have troops.
A runoff meaning we vote again?
Yeah, that's right.
And so that's like in place, like if the mechanism leads to a runoff because there isn't a majority, It's in place, like it'll happen right away in a couple of weeks. How quickly does the runoff happen?
So it happens in Colorado in 10 days, you know what the results are. So it's on the same schedule as regular because what we have the mail ballots, you know, which I like, it's paper. You can mail it, you can drop it off. I drop it off, I'm paranoid. I do. So, but it's paper and you can't hack paper, and they keep it for 5 years and they can audit it and re-audit it, and they do. So I like that. So when you send in your ballot with it, you send it in, you sign it. If your signature is changed and that happens, like people have, you know, will have a stroke or something and your signature just looks different because it's wrinklier right now. They contact you and say, hey, your ballot, please prove that this is your signature. Just, you know, talk to our office. So they give you a week for what they call the ballot cure. So we have that week for the ballot cure and for the last of the, you know, military ballots. So we know for sure in 10 days who earned their win.
Okay,
but with rank choice, but you were going to explain with rank choice.
Oh, but even, but it's that way with rank choice or without rank choice. So you get preliminary results on election night, and then you get final results in 10 days.
And then you do a runoff right away?
That's right. So it's because all the ballots are in. So that's when you announce, you know, who won the runoff, if a runoff is needed.
With ranked choice, it can be announced right away. Our present system is in that scenario, then you have to send the ballots back out for the runoff, and people have to sign and da 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 da, and then turn them back in,
right,
and they have to be recalculated and all of that.
Exactly.
And that's when the military might not make that second round.
That's right.
So that's what the issue is.
Absolutely. Yeah. Oh, and for the people online, okay, that's in the presentation.
Okay.
But you're good. Anyway.
Okay. I was just going to use what I think is a really good example. You know, in 2020 with Georgia, remember, no one, you know, they had all those Senate races with Warnock and I forget all those people, but they, no one got a majority in the first thing, so they had to have the runoff. That was big national news, so, but the runoff was they had to all go back to the polls a second time.
Right.
So you have to get all those people, and if it's military, now you have to get them from overseas. With ranked choice voting, it would, the runoff is included because they're putting in their first, second, third choice, and you don't have to go recruit ballots and schedule another election and have people come back.
Absolutely.
Because it's already there. So it would have saved a lot of angst, I think.
Yes.
In Georgia.
Speaking of time, I have about 10 minutes.
Okay. Okay. I'm going to pause questions and just pop through the last of this because I got 10 minutes. So we have the states, we have the places we're using it. Next slide.
This one was the next slide. This was us.
Okay, and do you have another? Okay, yeah. Here we go. So this is what it means in Colorado, is you get rid of the spoiler effect. Every now and then somebody will drop in an extra candidate just to mess up the election. You know, they'll pay somebody to run. That happens. Well, you can't mess up a ranked choice election like that. First of all, we can all smell that outside money every single time, right? Mm-hmm. You know AstroTurf when you see it, and they're not going to mess it up because there's that, you know, you find the consensus of a majority. So we'll pop on to the next. It's issue-based campaigns. That's what wins in ranked choice. They have to tell you what they plan to do. They can't just say that other candidate's hair is too weird, or you know what they say awful things about each other, and it's not relevant, right? It's just not relevant. Next slide. And we know that voters like it. And in the Utah GOP uses this. They've been doing it for a decade. 90% of them say they really like it. And, you know, the remainder say, for the most part, meh, no opinion. You always have that sliver, that 1%, that 0.5% that's, you know, doesn't like anything. That's life. But it's really every place that uses it, the voters like it. Sir?
How do you measure voter satisfaction?
Oh, we do polls. So for instance, for Basalt, we got in a grant and we were able to hire Triton Polling to call the voters in Basalt to say, what did you think? Were the ballots easy? Did you feel that you were heard? Did you feel the campaigns were more or less focused on the issue? So that's how we know. We have hire outside pollers to come up with that. It doesn't, you know, me calling them saying, You liked it, right?
Yeah.
No, no, it's unbiased.
Yeah.
Board people doing it. Next. Okay, so, and Colorado Springs, and this is exactly what you all were saying. So, is that it saves the city money, it saves everybody time, and it helps our troops. So we'll go to the next. There we go. So exactly what we mean by saving money, the city spends well over $500,000 every time they have a runoff. So the software costs a little bit more, but you end up saving money by avoiding the runoff. But even if you use it for every single election that's local, for, you know, the elections that are just council, it wouldn't cost the city extra money. And we know that the mayoral campaigns, you know, where there's a majority requirement, they don't have to go pounding on doors looking for more money. It saves the campaigns money, so they don't have to mess with it. And we can go to the next. It saves time for the city elections. So I know, you know, people in your regular jobs, if you have the threat that you're going to have to do a whole separate project, that's not a good thing. If you have it clear what your projects are for the year, that you know you don't have to run a runoff, that makes your life a lot easier. And so it saves the city money, it saves some time, it saves the voters the annoyance of having to show up and vote again. And it means you get to just vote honestly. If there's a, you know, a candidate that people say, well, I don't know if that person's really got a chance of winning, so what? You say what you want, and you get heard for saying that. So you get to vote honestly. And we can go to the next. And it supports the troops. Currently, they have to trust this electronic system. So the majority of overseas voters here from Colorado Springs, they use the VOATZ, V-O-A-T-Z app that uses blockchain technology, and it's probably safe, but probably shouldn't be a word, you know, in elections. So, you know, if they're comfortable with it, they can use it. If they're not comfortable with it, they should be able to use a ranked choice ballot and know they'll be heard. But they should have the freedom and to know they are being heard and that we know that they're being heard. So that's, you know, really what is a huge thing for this community, to make sure our overseas voters are heard. And I think that's it. If you, you know, have a system that pressures voters to pick a lesser of two evils or to vote strategically, that's not freedom for the voters and it's not fair for the candidates. So there it is. And there's a few QR codes. If I think go to the next one, there's a book on the topic. Oh, and this QR code goes to the, the way you do QR codes is you go like you're taking a picture of a thing. And then it'll pop up with a, like a little yellow square around it. You just pop, get on that. And what do you know, it comes up. So that's how you do that. And then the next one is from the Independence Institute, Barry Fagan, who's a professor over at the Air Force Academy, wrote up the conservative case for RCV. So he did the deep dive into the, you know, the founding fathers and all of that. And he says, you know, the alternate domination of one faction over another, sharpened by the spirit of revenge, is itself a frightful despotism. So that's... That's
George, not Barry.
Yeah. That's right. That is Barry quoting George Washington. Very smart, you know that's funny. No, smart. And there we go. And I think, what do we do next?
Questions? I was going to say, do you have any questions? You might have some.
Well, I know because I was receiving some emails along the way from others interested in this topic, that we call it alternative voting systems, right? And there is more than just RCV, right? Choice voting. They were mentioning some other forms. Maybe you would just mention the names of these other forms of alternative voting?
Absolutely. So there's, anytime you're doing polling, there's different ways to ask the questions. So you can do a ranking, which is what the political scientists are saying is what works best or something that's going to matter to you in a material way a week later, and you are an interested party. Now, if you are not interested, you can make a quick decision. Like if you are in a political party and you're picking delegates to a convention, just use approval voting. Just say, meh, these 10 people will be good enough. That's fine. That's a good way to make a quick decision. If you need a crew to decide which bar to go to next, quick show of hands, out you go, right? That's a good way to make decisions. Another method is a scoring system. So if you're a committee and you're trying to make a decision and everybody's doing the deep dive, you've got like the rules of what is an 80%, what's a 90%, you know, none of you own the restaurant you're picking for the whole banquet to be at. You know, if you're a disinterested party and you're gonna really spend the time on it, a scoring system is a good way to make a decision. And you can do it again and again each year. So those are methods of polling people. So that's, and there's some folks who think it, you know, those methods could be used in elections, but when we've studied them, they don't shake out that well. People end up gaming it. So, ma'am.
Earlier you said that you only pick three choices.
It depends on us.
You can have more than three.
Right. In Colorado, you'll have six choices to make. You'll have a long list of however many candidates, and you can go up to six choices.
And then, then we can go to more than just one runoff?
It goes until you find who earned the win. So it can go a few rounds.
One, you eliminate one?
That's right. Each time you just eliminate whoever's the least popular, because you want to keep all the candidates in as long as you can and give everybody as much of a chance to win as possible. Okay.
Who decides whether we get ranked choice voting or not?
Okay. So in Colorado Springs, so the question is who decides whether or not this goes forward? In Colorado Springs, the city council can directly decide to do it.
No.
Or voters can go forward.
That's a good girl.
What RCV for Colorado has been doing is supporting local initiatives. We prefer that things be council referred.
How about the state?
So for the state, what we're looking at is a legislatively referred ballot measure in 2024. Mm-hmm. Should everything go smoothly and we know, that it's reliable, it's fully audited, that it runs as well as it did, for instance, in New Mexico. It ran perfectly.
Why do we have to wait that long?
I know, right? Okay, so the reason we're waiting that long is the county clerks said, and the county clerks have the hardest time with this, right? Because for us as voters, it's easy. You just say what you really want. For the candidates, it's a little harder because you learn that you can't resort to slinging mud. Okay, you have to have a better plan. But for the clerks, it's more work because you have more voters asking questions. You have, there's more nuts and bolts. So we make sure that it's, they have the videos ready to go and all of that. And the County Clerks Association has said to us, look, please, run this in at least one county coordinated race before asking us to do it in 64 counties all at the same time. Let us run it in a small scale, learn what we're going to learn, and then know we're going to have a very solid rollout. So as much as voters such as myself are ready for it yesterday, we want to make sure that everyone can have full faith in the implementation.
But if the state passes it, then all elections using it, or
excellent question. State. So the question is, if the state passes it, what happens? How many elections does it apply to? So this would be for the statewide races. It's always local option for the municipality. So if a city doesn't feel like it, the city doesn't do it. Mail ballots are like that. Glendale, Colorado, you have to show up in person, and they had an election in April 2020, and 14 people turned out to vote. Mm-hmm. Because, pandemic. If they wanted to, Nobody cared about mayor that much.
Well, thank you. Any questions?
Are you running into any opposition among your elected officials at any level?
Yeah, so there's every political party has a small group that does not like this because they have to change what they're doing and they don't want to change. So every, you know, political viewpoint has that subset of people who don't want to change. So that's the main part of the opposition, and the opposition says this is too hard for the voters. And which was the height of hilarity. I was at a booth in Broomfield and we had a candy election. And so there were little pumpkins about this tall ranking their choices. They couldn't read yet, but they certainly had opinions on Halloween candies. And they were, you know, working their ballots. You had to tell them which line was which candidate, but they, you know, they understood it. And somebody was trying to say, oh, well, isn't this too hard? It's like, sir, observe the gentleman next to you. You know, he's this tall and he's handling it. So, but that's one of the things folks say. Sir.
I'm going to call it a debacle in Alaska.
You may fairly call it a debacle in Alaska.
All of the years that I've voted, it's been pretty much black and white.
Mm-hmm. Yes, sir.
So now you throw in all of these options. The thing that comes to my mind is, if you're in a frat house or a sorority, then this is the kind of voting that you get out of it.
I'd say approval voting is the, you know, a quick show of hands. It is more, you know, for the fraternity sorority set. But, you know, what went, Alaska did not have a great rollout, and their problem was they didn't have enough candidates in the race. So they had a top four primary, and they're kind of doing things their own way for Alaska reasons. Okay, so they had a top four primary. They had four candidates advance, and then one of the candidates dropped out. So they only had three choices, and one of the choices was Sarah Palin. 30% of people in Alaska like her. 70% of people in Alaska cannot stand her. And so in the final round, she had 30% of the support. But it's because Nick Begich did not run, who was the middle guy, did not run a good campaign. He did not tell people, here's what I plan to do in office. Whereas, and you know, Mary Peltola, although she has a D next to her name, she is to the right of Joe Manchin. She's to the right of Kyrsten Sinema. Her slogan was faith, family, and fishing. So she's very conservative. So, you know, people settled for her over Palin. But I would like to see a more robust campaign this next round, because we now have fully four candidates in. There's a libertarian who, he says he's not changing his fishing schedule to run. So I don't know. Hopefully he runs a good campaign. But from what I've heard, Begich's campaign is doing a better job. So knock on wood.
At the point that there were just not enough candidates to make the process look right, or the guy dropped out, or what was that problem?
Right, right. So the problem was there weren't enough candidates on the ballot that ran a good campaign. So if you, for instance, only vote for one candidate and you do my way or the highway and you don't have a backup plan, and some of Begich's voters just voted him.
Yeah, okay.
And so then they're, you know, in the corner holding their breath saying, I'm not going to participate in the final round. Okay. And they didn't participate because some people have told them, you know, I don't like ranked choice, don't rank.
Okay.
So hopefully, you know, people have learned a thing. And that's why we encourage political parties to start using this early and, you know, make your mistakes while the stakes are low.
Okay, it's me again. I'm a teacher. Sorry. I can think as I was teaching people. So in other words, you're saying like the Alaska or any ranked choice voting, it's you're doing your own, as a voter, you're doing a disservice to yourself by only picking the one person.
That's right.
So it's the same thing as saying, I'm going to vote in the first round, and when my candidate or no one gets 50%, so there has to be a runoff, I'm just not going to vote the second time around.
Right.
That's,
right.
That's basically what you're saying when you don't choose.
That's right.
In your rank shift. You should say, well, I'm just not voting this second time.
Yeah. I mean, okay. I mean, your vote can still stay there, but right. I was one of the top candidates, you know, but, you know, you run the risk because you didn't say what your backup plan is.
Okay.
Yeah.
No cookies at all.
I'm playing off.
Right? Yes. Well, we're going to have more time for more questions, hopefully. There's still some at the, we have an opportunity for, you know, some banter back and forth about this. I think we're all kind of thinking, how would this feel for me? Do I like this idea? You know, I've always voted one way. This would be different. So we've asked two informed individuals to help us today with that. And actually, we've asked three informed individuals to help us with that today. I'd like to introduce Beth Hendricks, who is our League of Women Voters president of Denver. She's coming down here today. Colorado. And she's come down. She's our League president of Colorado. She's come down from Denver today. And I appreciate that tremendously. She's going to moderate the conversation, the discussion between two participants from our community. We have Dutch Schultz here today, who is, I believe, you were past president of the North End, current president of the North End. He's been in our community quite a long time and has an opinion about ranked choice voting that he's going to share with us over the conversation. And we have Gary Casimir, who is a podcaster known to some of you throughout their area from his podcast. And he is also going to be able to share his thoughts on why he might like having. So have I presented this for you?
Sure.
Please tell us about yourself if you'd like to. And then the gentlemen want to tell us just a little bit about themselves too.
And if they would mind coming up here, I need you close to the speaker so those on Zoom can hear you. Mr. Gary and Mr. Dutch. From a panelist, please.
Can't hear you if you're way over there. And it's peak reality check, right, Gary?
Say again?
Peak reality check is your podcast?
Nope.
Oh, what? Oh, I'm just putting podcaster then.
Studio 809's podcaster. How about that?
Oh, send the biscuit.
Okay.
Oh, El Paso County Progressive. Got it.
Oh, no.
Thank you.
Oh, they were. Well, they did. Yeah.
Well, good afternoon. Thank you for being here. I'm Beth Hendricks. I'm the executive director of the League of Women Voters of Colorado, and I'm very pleased to moderate this panel. The League of Women Voters was founded 102 years ago to educate voters and empower democracy. And education presentations such as this are central to our very mission. In the next couple of weeks, the Colorado League will be distributing our nonpartisan information on the 11 state issues that will appear on our ballot. This will be the 84th edition of the League's ballot issues, first published in 1936. We hope you'll take advantage of this information. All info can also be accessed through our Vote 411 website as well. So you have several options to help you be an informed and confident voter. As you all well know, this presentation is hosted by the League of Women Voters of the Pikes Peak region, which serves both El Paso and Teller counties. This vibrant group of volunteers work to ensure all voters are informed and confident when filling out their ballots, and that municipal and county governmental entities operate in the sunshine and with the public's best interests at heart. We also have a group of volunteers statewide working in a task force to educate on alternative voting methods and inform our advocacy efforts. This task force is open to anyone interested and happens to have a virtual meeting coming up on Monday evening at 6:30 p.m. All are welcome, and you may sign up on LWVCO's website to receive the Zoom link. LWVCO does have six other such task forces: housing, healthcare, reproductive justice, climate emergency, gun violence prevention, and News Access and Literacy that have identical missions, but obviously different subject matter. These task forces are open to anyone interested and are a great way to get involved in a topic about which you may have a passion and a desire to act. So, but back to the issue at hand, ranked choice voting. In 2017, LWVCO adopted the following position by concurrence with LWV Boulder. Support authorizing and implementing alternatives to plurality voting that allow people to express their preferences more effectively. The League supports gaining on-the-ground experience with alternative voting methods to ascertain whether a voting method results in outcomes that match voters' preferences as recorded on their ballots. The League supports voting methods that improve the election experience, that encourage honest rather than tactical voting, and that consider ease of implementation. Considerations include some voting methods are intended for single winner elections, others for multi-winner elections. It is important that the intended use of a voting method match its actual application. Multi-winner voting methods can promote proportional representation, which fosters diversity in our elected officials. Election officials should conduct post-election analysis to evaluate the voters' usage of the voting method and the election's reflection of voters' stated preference. There should be enough data transparency, for example, access to ballot records in anonymous form, for an independent analysis to be conducted by other interested group. A voting method encourages honest voting when it allows voters to meaningfully support all their preferred candidates rather than leading them to either not support their favorite or tactically indicate a higher preference for a candidate who is not their favorite. So, a lot of words to say that the League supports the study and implementation of alternative voting methods as a way to better support voter preference. The League does not state which alternative voting method is best, leaving that choice up to the voting entity, be it a municipality, county, state, whatever. So joining us today are two distinguished speakers who I hope will allow voters to learn more about ranked choice voting. Gary Casimir is a podcaster with Studio 809, and Doug Schultz is the president of the Old North End Neighborhood. I would like to allow each of them to introduce themselves. Then I'd like to give each of them 1 minute to explain their stance on ranked choice voting. An earlier coin toss determined that Mr. Schultz will speak first. We'll then alternate order.
Wait, I didn't toss it.
I did.
Very democratically.
Okay. First, I want to make an administrative statement. There are a couple of them. Number one, I do have to be the president of the Old North End, but that's incidental to my appearance here, and I'm not representing anything from the Old North End as such. However, before I take that hat off, I do want, as president of the Old North End, to express our gratitude forever to the League of Women Voters in Patrick Reed for their defense of the park and the neighborhood against the city, who wanted to take Monument Marrow and push it through to I-25. They were going to go right through Monument Valley. And the only people who stepped forward and stopped it was the League of Women Voters.
Okay. Yay for us.
The Dutchess, we're the one who led the charge to have the voters vote that only the voters can decide if the city's going to sell or trade parkland, which our city did before we got that vote. So that's a follow-up. It's always a big issue.
Fortunately, General Palmer, when he transferred the land to the recipients, said to the people, the citizens of Colorado Springs, not to the city. And that was the vital decision. Anyhow, thank you. I'll now pick up that hat and two other administrative things. One is I was wounded in Vietnam and a rocket attack and it blew out my high range hearing. So I may have difficulty, particularly with women. Anyone here yet? I can hear what you're saying. I just can't understand it. So I'll get an interpreter.
Yeah, it's not just the women.
Not yet. Okay. That I think I chewed up my minute pretty good.
Gary, would you like to introduce yourself?
Well, my name is Gary Kasmer, and I do have a podcast with the Progressive Veterans of El Paso County, and he's been running it since January, and basically pulling up my little tent on Studio 809, and that's fine. And of course, I was engineering Bill Murray's, Councilman Bill Murray's podcast, and a couple of weeks ago, Bill says, I've had it, you know, and it came down to a vote on the city council, and he just basically quit. So he didn't quit council, he just quit the podcast. But I've been involved with Right Choice Voting since probably about 2016. That's Linda and I kind of met about that time frame. And I made presentations to city council. Richard Scorman, council, stood up there in front of us. In 2016, the state revised the municipal election code, which allowed cities to adopt ranked choice voting. So guys, why not? Crickets, unfortunately. But here we are today. 6 years later, we're still, you know, trying to get it passed. And, you know, all we need is 9 council members to do it. Excuse me, 5 council
members. Is it 9?
Super majority, yeah.
We had a meeting recently. That's good, positive.
Yeah, but 5 council members to tell Sarah Johnson implement it. It's that simple. So that's about all I got to say, and I'm waiting to see what Dutch is going to be doing. And if you see me taking these, I got a tickle in my throat that causes a cough, so I'm trying to keep that down to a minimum. So
just briefly, I said there were 3 administrative things that I wanted to say. The third one was the reason I'm wearing this Jerry Garcia tie is in honor of a friend of mine, Warren Lindquist. Some of you may know him. He was an orthodontist. He died. I'm going to a funeral at 3:00, so I will be out of here. And that's that.
I'm glad to add, I also live in the old North End. I live in the Swami Park.
That's your address.
Okay. First question. How would ranked choice voting impact our local community? Dutch, 1 minute.
Well, the major concern is that we have always had a two-party system. Now, local elections tend not to be along with one, but I think mostly it is a solution in search of a problem. And we really haven't had the problems that you think. You think it was a divisive now, a two-party system goes through the Civil War. And so you don't need to have this revolutionary idea and start having 3 and 4 different choices in your elections. Now, locally, that's fine. I don't have a problem with that. But I think William L. Buckley said it best in a column, if you remember him. He said he'd rather be ruled by the first 100 people in a phone book than by the faculty of Yale College, meaning don't think up these ideas.
Thank you. Gary, same question?
Same question, power. That's what it's going to change, is the power structure in the city. Right now, we're pretty well aware of the developer basically running roughshod over city council, which is basically rubber stamps and projects. And with ranked choice voting, we can change that power structure and make it more towards the citizens. Because how many of you have gone to a meeting for the city You stood up there and said, hey, I want this, I want that. And you know what? You completely ignored her. Yeah. Okay. You know what I'm talking about. So changing the power structure is our primary thing. It also works at the county level. We need to change the power structure at the county level.
Next question.
Wait a minute, I might be for this.
I was going to say, did you say that you were for it locally? Did I hear you say that?
Well, you have more choices, but I don't understand how that would change it. Yeah, how would ranked choice voting
change power?
You're talking about for the council or for the commission?
Well, let's talk council, city council.
Okay. You basically only had two Democrats on the council. If they want to put a label on it, Richard Squirman and Bill Murray. The rest of them go along to get along with their political ambition, which I'm sorry, but I don't agree with their position there. We can do better. We've got to do better. And as I've said on Bill's show before, we have reached a tipping point with the city. If we do not change the power structure, Colorado Springs will just become another wide spot in the road, people going north or south, and maybe stopping by and having a Cane's fried chicken or whatever it is, happens to be on the corner off the off ramp. So we need to change that power structure.
How does ranked choice voting change the power structure is what I don't understand. Can you explain that to me? What does that mean? Because for me, if I look from a, if I'm going to vote April, right?
Okay.
April elections are coming up,
that's right.
Correct? So it won't be implemented in April, but how would that change my voting habit as a voter with regards to the power come April? I don't
know. Okay. How about more candidates? How about more people running? More votes.
Okay.
I mean, when you take the southeast part of town, it's got the lowest voter turnout of any section of the city. The last election, total voter rollout was 24%. We have a minority government right now. 24% of the people elected this present council. And I would venture to say there's a few people out there who aren't happy with that decision. So, I mean, that's what it would change. It would increase the voter turnout, increase the quality of candidates, hopefully, and, you know, make things better.
Who's going to run for council and pay $6,250 a year?
You.
Other than retired military. Seriously. I mean, I would love to see, a lot of young people have said they'd like to run. They can't afford to run for a job
that
pays
$6,000. If we can get the, you know, high-fisted voters to increase that salary to $40,000 or $50,000 a year to have subsistence pay, then chances are we'll get some better quality candidates. But we've got to break the cycle of the military on that council.
The exact number is paying $61,452.
Sorry, that's...
Okay. That is the median income of people in El Paso County.
I believe it.
Or at least it was a while back.
Jane, question.
Please.
Because you mentioned the park challenge, I saw one candidate.
Yeah.
In this whole last year. Really sweet lady. But when you talk about there's not anything coming out of that part of town, there is no incentive. Nobody's coming to us. Nobody's
right.
Speaking about the issues. And then the one person that comes through who presented to me a good platform.
Right.
But then, like you were saying about the power struggle, you don't kill that with increasing the amount of candidates. You kill that by killing the power. In other words, and this is hypothetical, but you take away the oil people, you take away the lifetime politician, you take away the high-priced developers, and you make it
a people's vote, you don't need 5,000, hypothetically, 5,000 candidates.
No.
You need a system of four or five candidates or three or four candidates that have the totality of the population at their heart and not who's got the bigger buck to push the person into the position.
When I was on the Charter Review Committee back in 2004, Bob Levy, some of you may know him, he and I, we took positions. My position was get rid of the at-large candidates and large council members and have all of my district. He said, well, I'll compromise and I'll go for six council seats and two at-larges. And we ended up with three at-larges and five council candidates for six. So, but I mean, that was going on there. Lionel Rivera shot us in the backside on that one because it was consensus to do that. And Lionel said, oh, we don't want to do that, you know, it might disrupt things around there. Good.
That's actually what was brought up in the chat. One question from Celeste Landry. Did anyone talk about the proportional form of RCV to elect the three at-large members? Or is the proposal to elect the three at-large in single winner contests? So again, what we're talking about are just different types of alternative voting. Is that what I hear? It's not necessarily, according to Celeste's question, is again, she's talking the proportional form of RCV to elect the three at-large members, or are we talking the proposal to elect the three at-large in single winner contests? What does that mean?
Can I do that?
Sure, please.
According to the rules with the secretary, let me make sure I've got it for these folks too.
Thank you.
The for the people at the Secretary of State's office, set it up so that it is proportional when you do at-large seats. And that was something that was done under the direction of then Secretary of State Wayne Williams, and my organization absolutely supports that at-large seats are elected proportionally. That way everyone gets their fair share of the say.
What does that mean, proportionally to what, compared to what?
Oh, so if about a third of the people have a viewpoint, then about a third of the seats go to that viewpoint.
I'm not understanding. We're talking about one person.
Oh, okay. So at the at-large seats. So when you're electing three seats at the same time.
All at-large.
At-large. Okay. So that's what.
You're electing a panel, but isn't that correct?
Right. So absolutely. You cannot proportionally elect one person.
Mm-hmm. It's all equal between the three. If there were three at-large seats, they all get the equal amount of votes. Is that what I hear?
Along those same lines, okay. Right? You share power across the city, across the viewpoints.
Okay. Hope that answers your question, Celeste. Thank you.
So, gentlemen, what barriers and what benefits do you see in changing the voting system? Gary, you're first.
What barriers?
Mm-hmm.
Politicians, city council. It starts right there and it ends right there. Plain simple. It's not rocket science. You know, we've discussed it in the past, what needs to be done. But you can't get those five council members on board to change it over. I would venture to say if somebody asks Sarah Johnson if she's already got the right choice building package in an upgrade from ESS, which is a system user, she's going to say, yes, I've got it. Okay. It's just a matter of saying, do it. And of course, myself, personally, I want to see the county run the election. I want to get the city out of the election business because it will save $500,000 every other election dollars because we won't have to put up with the runoffs. By incentive. Okay.
Dutch?
I think the biggest problem that we have is not that people are having a hard time voting for people they want. It's trying to get the candidates to run that we want. And that's not going to change with the opt-in system. That's, regardless of how you vote, is not going to change who the candidates are. And as Judith pointed out, pay is a big issue. Colorado Springs has grown out of a big city now. The city way back at the 1900 paid a good wage for city council people. And they paid the mayor as well. That got dropped with feeling that they were too independent. But think about it, if you knew your job, your paycheck depended upon responding to the voters, you would be more responsive.
Now, Gary, you seem to believe that adopting ranked choice voting would increase voter turnout.
Yes.
Dutch, you seem to believe that it will have no effect on voter turnout. Is that correct?
Correct.
Okay, I'll take St. Paul as a prime example. St. Paul introduced ranked choice voting 2012, and they had an increase of 12% on that cycle. 4 years later, it was 43% increase. Mm-hmm. Yeah, an increase in voter participation because people have a reason to vote. So I'm in that camp. We'll increase it, and we have to increase it. As I said, we cannot continue letting the minority elect our council. We need the majority to elect the council. And one of the examples I use here is if we had ranked choice voting when John Southers ran for mayor the first time, we'd have been saying Madam Mayor, not Mr. Mayor. I think Mary Lou Makepeace would have cleaned his clock.
Jeff, would you like to?
I can't comment on the elections in St. Paul. I am totally ignorant on that and why the voters increased there. I'm sure there are a multitude of reasons. It's hard for me to see how just changing the voting method would increase the votes. But once again, I feel just inherently that when you have a simple plurality, that means whoever gets the most vote win. People understand that, right? And that's fairly simple.
Go ahead.
That question I gave you, go ahead and ask it.
Now, number one, we need a system that's inclusive. And we definitely do not have that in Colorado Springs. You used the word just now, and by Gary saying something, I lost it. What did you use? Plurality?
Plurality.
Okay, and plurality, what you really meant to say is monopoly. Okay, you may not meant, but in my brain, okay, that when you come down to the way we vote for city council now, it's pretty much a monopoly. You have two or three people that rise to the top because they have the power and the money. And most people are saying, well, it doesn't make sense for me to vote, I can't win. So I hear what you're saying that you don't believe that the power is what causes people to have distrust, but it is the power. And it's kind of hard not to see that after 56 years, that's how long I've been here, okay? That the money brings the power. We should have long ago voted in an increase for people, for city council, that more than a couple of folks could afford to run. And especially those neighborhoods that back up against downtown, okay? Downtown pulls a lot of power and money, where the neighborhoods around downtown don't wanna be sucked into downtown. We would like, especially those older neighborhoods, to have some autonomy. They have just the best of everything as far as I'm concerned, because that's where I am. Okay. But when you don't have the money, and of course you're not paying as much in taxes, and you don't have a lot of freedoms, you cannot sit around and go to a meeting and everybody has a white face and everybody has gray hair. It's really kind of discouraging. I'm sorry.
I was just thinking about something addressing. You were talking about the power and the more choice, and I'm thinking, again, this is a teacher in me, a real life example of Doug Lamborn. We know this is a Republican county, pretty much Republicans are always going to win. Doug Lamborn, if you don't remember, he got in because he was appointed after Bruce went to jail or something like that. And you know, incumbents win, Republicans win in this county. But from polling I've seen over the past, what is it, dozen years? Republicans themselves have polled saying they don't like Lamborn. They want another Republican. But every time there's other choices in the primary, it is not ranked choice. So all the I don't like Lamborn people split their votes between the three or four other ones. And guess what? He gets back in again. And so he's got the power. He's got the incumbent. He's been there. No one else can win. And
how would ranked choice voting change that?
Okay, because of what you're saying, you could say vote 1, 2, 3, 4.
Right.
Okay.
It might.
It might not, but it could change it. You have more of a chance because if he does not get the majority, then that means we're going to be looking at his like second choice for all those other people. Those second choice might pile on to the person who came into number two after Lamborn and not put Lamborn on top. And I've been very frustrated with that because it's like, why vote for representative in here? It's always going to be Lamborn. So it's like, why vote?
Lamborn won with 34%.
Yeah, Okay.
If we had ranked choice voting then, he would have never been elected.
Exactly. I can't remember the details of every election. I quit looking. I was like, he's going to win. Who cares?
I think Linda will hopefully back me up on this. The state is trying to remedy that problem by making all federal offices part of ranked choice voting.
Yeah.
I mean, that's one way we can get rid of it. In fact, I think at one primary season, some young lady almost took Lamborn out.
I kind of remember that too. Yeah.
Good luck to her on that one. I wish come back, please.
So I always wish those election was him and one other person, but it's always him and like three other people. Why bother? Okay.
Virtual questions, if you guys don't mind us popping in for a virtual, please. I've got two. Couldn't a citizens initiative propose a change to the charter to adopt IRV RCV for single winner seats and STV RCV for multi-winner seats? That's one question. Can I get an answer to that one first? Could a citizens initiative propose a change to the charter to adopt IRV RCV for single winner seats and STV RCV for multi-winner seats? Is that possible?
Yes, it could.
Yes, thank you very much. And Greg, I'm sorry, Dutch, this one is specifically for you. Clarify why you think plurality is better than majority, please.
Well, the majority only comes about if you have somebody who represents a larger spectrum of what is popular. It's not that one is better than the other, it's that they're both leaders and the one that's the most popular of the choices you have. There is no need to have a leader who represents the majority, who has over 51%. It's not a flaw. It's not a problem. You know, you have to look at the Constitution and how it was structured. If you're trying to get this nirvana of getting over 51%, ranked choice voting does that artificially. It forces it eventually because of the methodology. But I don't think people are going to go, oh, yeah, that's the guy. In fact, if you look at it, you probably can wind up with a case where somebody who didn't have any first choices would actually be the most popular. If you follow what I'm saying, if you look at the methodology. Go ahead and comment on that.
Thank you. And these are excellent points to for the discussion. So I really appreciate it. So, you know, the people who don't have as many first choice votes get eliminated early. So that's you know, one of the things there. And, you know, for your executive seats, it's great to have somebody with a broad majority, because, you know, the majority of people agree we at least trust this person. So to it being a, whether it's a forced majority, I'll point to an example, because I do sample elections all the time. So I did one for some Democrats around the debates and some in 2020, and somebody walked in saying, well, you know, I'm voting for Bernie. I can't stand that Kamala. Can't stand her. And then Kamala won. And that was the first debate. Kamala won. Same person said, yeah, you know, she did a lot of consumer protections. How did that happen? I mean, but people compromise on their ballot and accept the results as being, it's like when you go to a restaurant, you get there, your restaurant has nobody in it, but the one across the street is full. You think, that restaurant probably has better food. You update your opinion. So that's from the world, you know, experience with it. That's how people relate to it. And that's why it's so popular with the voters. But I understand where you're coming from.
We also got one more thing on Zoom for me, if you don't mind. So LWVCO got the majority criterion eliminated from the proposed national concurrence because no voting method guarantees a majority when there are more than two candidates. Is that right?
Yes.
Okay. And then, sorry, Celeste, not that I totally disagree, but I just kind of want a clarification on that. I'm reading right. And the U.S. Fair Representation Act would change the congressional elections to create multi-member districts and use STV-RCV, proportional RCV, to elect them. Most people would get someone that they like elected to the U.S. House of Representatives. What does that mean? Can you explain what that means?
I would prefer if Celeste or Linda did.
Celeste, can you explain what that U.S. Fair Representation Act means for us, please?
I'll try. So right now, Colorado has, eight representatives coming up this year, getting elected. And what the U.S. Fair Representation Act would do is create two districts instead of eight districts. One of the districts would elect three members to the U.S. House of Representatives. The other district would elect five members to the U.S. House of Representatives. And you would use proportional ranked choice voting. And so the woman who is unhappy that the vote splitting happens and Doug Lamborn is always elected, would probably get somebody that she likes elected. And Doug Lamborn might still get elected, but instead of having winner take all districts, you would have proportional representation. So in a state like Massachusetts, which elects only Democrats, you would have a Republican member of the U.S. House of Representatives. Other states which elect only Republicans would probably have, unless it's a single member, unless it's Wyoming, which has only one member of Congress of the U.S. House of Representatives. If you have several, you would probably have at least one of each party elected.
Thank you.
Use a ranked choice ballot, and then the tally is the same method. There's one step that goes unused when you have a single winner election. So we call that RCV 102. But there's places that have both types. Minneapolis has, you know, ranked choice voting. Some of the seats are single winner, some are multi-winner seats, and the voters handle it fine because the voters want to know, what am I doing with my ballot? It's the same thing. And then they want to know who won. And, you know, you still find out in the same period of time who earned the win. And what works really well about that for a legislature or for a city council is that you're hearing all the different ideas, not just, you know, what the consensus is with the majority. You're hearing everybody's point of view. So that's the version John Stuart Mills was a huge fan of, and that's pointed to in the conservative case for ranked choice voting, that everybody gets their fair share.
I do expect to hear a lot more about proportional representation in the coming future.
I'm getting a little confused by all these different, it's really interesting the different regional or local impacts that we've caused, but it would seem that it's only in two districts and each district has multiple can't elect people that you can elect, then the risk is very high that they would have to one specific geographic region. You know, a very small, you know, block in Colorado Springs close to half the state or something.
Broadly. Right. And historically, and so that's one of the things that we keep an eye on. We see that historically they tend to be spread out. And I have a conversation coming up with a woman from Australia where they use this system, but they make sure that each region has somebody that you talk to. So it's not, you know, hey, this thing is happening at, you know, the park in my region. Nobody cares because nobody's from there. No, they don't have that problem. They have somebody from that place also. So it's a mechanics issue.
More, yeah, that's just prep work, a lot of prep work mm-hmm. that we need to be accomplished in this time.
Yeah. And that's part of the conversation is how do you 100% make sure each place has a person that's in charge of, you know, fixing whatever goes sideways.
Geocivics. We have a great program at UCCS called Geocivics that was really important during the redistricting that really put a focus on geography.
Okay. Do we have time for one more question? I know that Dutch.
Let's hear it.
Great.
What about the answers to our constitutional question?
they're on the back.
They're on the bottom of the back.
Did
you get
100%?
You'll be great.
Paper. Some of those were trick questions. Okay, let's have a live question.
Okay, let's talk about cost or savings.
No one else. I will say that is insignificant compared to the total budget of the city. The decision should not be based on one or the other. Same thing. Paying a councilor, always talk about saving money if you're in council. It's insignificant compared to the total cost of running the city. You gotta pay the council and have the best representatives that you can.
Okay.
Oh, that's terrible. Not you.
The car. The car, right?
Are you able to answer, Gary?
Yeah, I think so, if I don't say too many words. We do need to pay council, bottom line. Second part of the bottom line is we gotta separate the utilities out of it. We have to have an independent utilities board.
Now, just a damn minute.
We're going down a rabbit hole here. Let's get back to the positives that either the.
Now we're gonna have fighting words.
Seriously.
Ranked choice voting electing the members of the utilities.
Okay.
Savings or cost, though, was the question, right?
Yes. Mm-hmm. Gary did mention savings. Earlier savings due to lack of insignificant.
Wait, do we get to elect the board members to the utility?
Yeah.
Okay, maybe we could do that.
Yeah, okay.
And would all the stakeholders in the utilities get to vote, or is it called spring?
It would just be Colorado Springs. Yeah. What we need to do basically is stop the annexations. You know,
I just want to say that I'm from Manitou Springs and we're a user of Colorado Springs Utilities, but we've got no vote, no say. And and it can independently raise rates on us.
That's the whole idea.
Yeah. But you just said we couldn't vote.
I live in Falcon and we pay gas. So I can vote on it.
It would be nice.
Why not?
The one thing we didn't talk about that was a negative of this to me as a voter, it's hard enough to educate voters. Okay. As a league, we are all about educating voters. And this is another thing that we would have to educate voters on. So, and I'm not saying that's a bad thing. I'm just saying that it's another hurdle for us. And as a voter,
are you afraid to work?
I work for free. So no, I am not.
Welcome to the world of podcasting.
Amen to that. But thank you. Thank you, Beth. Thank you, Beth.
Thank you both. I appreciate it very much. I think we've heard a lot of consensus that city council needs a big rest.
Yeah, right?
Yeah. So I just want to end this by saying thank you to everyone and hopefully we get you off on time. And we appreciate a program that ends on time, even if it didn't start on time. Right? So I want to tell you what the vote response was.
Okay.
Me being the simple-minded person that I was, took them out there and I was thinking, I don't know if I'm going to be able to do this, but there was a majority. Just like you said, happens 50% of the time. So even while we ran these different activities in Colorado, there ended up being a majority of the consensus that taking is the favorite. There was also, if you put it in percentages, 20% for hot springs and 20% for fly fishing. And one ballot got thrown out because someone didn't understand right choice voting.
So, see how that works.
If you want to discount your vote by not voting right. So, anyway, any other words? Anyone have anything else you want to share today?
I got something for the Zoom just to kind of wrap us up, if that's all right. Referring to the U.S. Constitution, Dutch, on yours. Please see this line from a bipartisan report on common purpose. Other rules of representation from single member districts to winner take all election systems are not required by the Constitution, but they are so ingrained in the voting systems of all the states that it often seems that they are the natural order of things. There's also a link in your Zoom for those of you that are not on it. We're saving your chat so you can see that as well, and we'll send it out. But thank you very much.
It is recorded.
It is recorded. Yes, ma'am. We recorded it. You got it.
Review or turn your friends on to it.
Yes. Thank you.
Thank you.
Great. Thank you, Zoom. Thank you for being here this afternoon. We'll send you all a link and you'll also get, make sure you see that thing. Thank you, Greg, for your comments and Celeste, everybody for attending today. Appreciate you.
Thank you. Yeah.